it's not often that a book stops you in your tracks with its portrayal of remarkable courage and resistance in the face of the most appalling situations. Heart of Darfur and The Road to Lost Innocence are two books that will help any reader to understand the human story behind the newspaper headlines. And our book reviewer, Kieran Grimes, is here to tell us more about them. Good morning, Kieran.
Good morning. How
These are books about the human spirit and the triumph of the human spirit in situations of appalling adversity.
Absolutely.
Start with the first one about Darfur.
Well, this book, it's written by a Kiwi, a nurse from New Zealand, mm-hmm. who lives in Auckland and was very unhappy with life, was very unfulfilled. And she works for Médecins Sans Frontières, mm-hmm. which is Doctors Without Barriers. And they're an organization which sends nurses, doctors, and non-medical people out to some of the worst war-torn countries and most deprived countries in the world to help with medical care and mm-hmm. other kind of social work. But she went to Darfur, and she didn't really know where it was, even. She had heard bits about it in the news, but she had a friend who was working there, and she had already been on a few missions before with Médecins Sans Frontières, so she decided to go back to Africa. She was in a different part before. And it's interesting, her very first experience of arriving there, she said it was, what she saw was a beautiful country. There was loads of bougainvillea, reds, greens, purples, beautiful flowers, people very happy. But then as she moved away from Khartoum, moved more into Darfur region, there were sandbags, there were guns, things weren't as what they seemed. And she kind of goes through, I mean, she doesn't really go into the whole situation as in why the war is happening, the whole political side of it, because it's quite complex. I mean, basically the Sudanese government are fighting with their own people in the west of the country.
The northern part of Sudan is Arab, the southern part is Christian.
Yes, it's absolutely, and the people in Darfur feel that the hugely Arab government are neglecting them because they're less Arab, mm. and basically the government are stamping their authority by doing air raids, and they do ground attacks. But anyway, she, for example, she describes a typical day for her would be, there is a militia there called the Janjaweed, and they're ordinary men who are, I suppose, funded by the government
Of course, the government denies this.
Well, they deny that, but they are...
they're basically doing the government's dirty work.
On the ground.
Yeah.
And basically, a typical day for her is that these attacks happen, truckloads arrive into the hospital and just more or less dump the casualties, and her with a handful of other medics have to deal with this. And she says all she can do is deal with them one by one.
And the Janjaweed don't concentrate on other adult fighting men or grown men.
Oh,
whoever and whatever gets in their way,
other civilians,
gets mown
and
down.
There's another story she speaks about which highlights their tactics very much into intimidation. And there was one woman who was called Miriam, was 9 months pregnant, and the Janjaweed, several of them gathered around her and started to taunt her and started to tease her, and were playing this game with her. They were saying, oh, you know, there's money in your stomach, we want it out, you know, and they beat her up, and as a result the woman labor was induced and she lost the child. Mm. And these kind of casualties were the typical casualties that she was confronted with. Sometimes when she was out in the field with clinics, now when I say clinic, it was under a tree in the back of a Land Rover, and she would, you know, come out of the Land Rover and there'd be 300 people there, and she might be the only medic there, and all she could do, you know, her attitude is, well, you start with one, you move on to the next, you move on to the next. So it's it gives a great flavour of the tone that's happening in this country.
And what was it that struck you primarily about the book?
I suppose it was her own courage. I mean, the situation is so vast, and you might wonder, how can one person make such a difference? And she probably didn't make that much of a difference in terms of the whole political war setup, but she did touch people's lives on the ground.
And you do one little bit of good, and somebody else does another bit, and gradually
absolutely.
You make a difference.
And she got to know people, she got to know their names. So that was the impact, that as an individual, you can do something. And she wrote the book to quote her, to tickle people's consciences, just to make people aware.
Is it well written?
It's very well written, which was, I didn't know what to expect.
So it's not just reportage?
No, it's very well written, and you can feel the wind and the heat and the smell of Darfur in her words. It's really well written.
All right, so that's called Heart of Darfur, by Lisa French
Blaker. Yeah.
Now the next one is The Road of
Lost Innocence.
Of Lost Innocence by, how do you say the name?
Somali Imam.
Now I've heard about this book, and I've read the presse of it, and if Darfur sounds bleak, this
this is even very, worse. I mean, this woman, she's from Cambodia. She was born there, and she doesn't actually know when she was born. She thinks it was 1970, 1971, but she was born in the jungle in northeast, I think, Cambodia. And her parents abandoned her as a child, and she was left to the care of her grandmother, who also then did a runner. And she was left in a small village, which was comprised of 12 huts. That was the setup. And she kind of grew up there, her very early years, wandering around, moving from kind of... No one was really taking care of her, but eventually she was sold into slavery by a so-called father figure who was called Grandfather.
Mm-hmm. And which is a common occurrence.
Which is a very common occurrence, because people there, it's quite common for children to be sold for $200, $300, because they don't have any money. Mm-hmm. She was sold...
Particularly girls, I would imagine.
Particularly girls. She ended up in slavery, and eventually she was sold into a brothel. In the capital at the age of 16. But by that time, I mean, it's horrific. She'd already been abused and raped about 70 times up until that time.
That was the thing that leaped off the page at me.
Yeah, I mean...
Once bad enough.
Just horrific. But she ended up in this brothel with other girls her age. And, you know, one night she speaks about seeing a friend of hers murdered by an angry pimp. And it was then that she thought, I have to get out of here, I have to do something. So with the help of an international aid, she managed to escape, and it was escape. Mm. And since then, she has set up her own organisation, and it's called Acting for Women in Distressing Situations. And what she does, she went back to Cambodia, and basically she conducts raids on these brothels to try and bring the kids out. And there's a street, it translates as Road of Lost Innocence, and it's an area of the capital which has just got a lot of brothels, where the title comes from.
Populated by...
By
abandoned children.
Absolutely. And on any one raid, she can get about 80 kids. Literally, she runs in, takes them out, and brings them to a rehabilitation centre. But unfortunately, a lot of the kids have got sisters who are there, and they don't want to leave them, so they go back, and they don't want to leave their siblings who maybe didn't escape in the raids. And so a lot of them don't end up being rehabilitated. But she's doing her best. I mean, she's only... she's around 37, 38 years old, and she's just achieved so much.
She's a strikingly beautiful woman,
absolutely,
isn't she?
Absolutely, yeah. And it's shocking, some of the stuff.
I'd imagine that's a tough read.
It is a very, very tough
read.
Again,
well-written?
It's very well-written. She writes it... She writes it with a certain detachment, as if she's a witness. It's not kind of steeped in
so
a lot of emotion.
So she's compartmentalised that part of her life.
And I think she had to try and get the message across, you know.
Okay, well, look, you've picked the two of those.
Yes.
Just there are three others, very quickly, and we can only mention them because we have to get Escape by Carolyn Jessup.
That's an insight into a polygamous community in America. It's a cult-like. It's the fundamentalist church of the Latter-day Saints, and she talks about escaping from that and how secretive they were with her children.
Okay. Hidden by Kathy Glass.
Kathy Glass is a foster carer, and she this is her second book, and this is she calls it a fostering memoir about this young Nigerian guy who comes to her care, and she just writes about his life.
Okay, and Not Without My Sister.
And Not Without My Sister, it's a story of three girls who were who were born into the Children of God cult, and it just talks about how again they were mistreated, abused, they were denied schooling, they were sent out in the streets to beg, and how they escaped from that life.
Actually, there's a big story in the papers this morning about one of those cults where I think they've rescued 300 kids from a similar sort of cult like that.
Okay.
So it's very much, very topical at the moment.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, Kieran, thank you very much indeed.
No problem.
Okay, we'll take a break and we'll see you back here in a few minutes' time.